We will be focusing on verses 11 through 32, and for those of you that are not familiar with this passage, this is talking about the prodigal sons. And I say that plural, and I mean to say it plural. It isn't, I used to think of it more along the lines as the prodigal family, because if you look at the actions of the father, he's just seems to be, let me put it that way, seems to be just as wasteful as the sons are, because he is willing to lavish his sons with his goods. But considering who the father is representing, God the Father, that father cannot be wasteful because he knows all, he sees all, and he is righteous in all of his doings. So, again, Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 32. This is the 36th parable in the book of Luke, and it is illustrating the differences, or the difference rather, between the concern of God and the murmuring of the Pharisees over the salvation of a lost soul. It is the difference. It's showing the difference, because if you study, Jesus is actually talking to the Pharisees in these illustrations, and he is taking them, mama, you don't have to stand, you can be seated, because I'm not going to read all my passages. I'm sorry, I'm not going to read all my passages and then expound. I'm going to read a little bit, expound, read a little bit, expound. So he is talking specifically to the Pharisees, who are snubbing their noses, if you will, at anyone and everyone that is not them. Does that not sound familiar? There are a lot of churches today that are filled with people like that. I thank God that we are not in a church as such. Now, I'd like to take a note here. There are three different parables in this same chapter. Three different parables in this chapter alone. From verses 1 through 10, it has two different parables. The first being talking about the shepherd who has 100 sheep. And then he finds, if he finds that one is lost, does he just shrug his shoulders and say, I still got 99. And look, I have a few of them that are pregnant, so I'm going to have more than 100 anyway. No. He stops what he's doing. He leaves the 100 in search of what? The one. The one that is lost. Now, how could that sheep be lost if it wasn't his to begin with? It was his to begin with, wasn't it? So he's seeking out that which is lost. And when he finds it, he rejoices. And in verse 7, it says, Jesus speaking, I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. Then he goes into the second parable, and it's the parable of the woman who has 10 coins, 10 pieces of silver, if you will. Actually, that's how it's put in, displayed here. And then he says, hey, buddy. Then he says, if, again, if one is lost, she seeks it out to find it. And when she finds it, she rejoices that it is found. But she doesn't just keep her door shut. She doesn't just stay inside the house. What does she do? She opens up the windows and she hollers to her neighbors and says, hey, come rejoice with me, because I found that which was lost. And then verse 10 says, likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. Come, rejoice with me. So in these two parables, that person owning all things, if you will, spoken of, seeks out and finds that which is lost. So an example, the Holy Spirit is seeking out that which is lost and brings that lost soul into the fold, brings that lost piece of silver back into his pocket, back into his hand, back to the hand of the Father. So then you have those two parables that are the leading up of this third and final parable in this chapter alone. And this chapter, verse 11, again, chapter 15, Luke chapter 15, beginning in verse 11, and we're going to read verses 11 through 16. And he said, a certain man had two sons. How many sons did he have? Two. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. What are swine? Pigs, hogs. The nasty of nasties. If you study the keepers of hogs in this day was the lowest of lows. They weren't even allowed to marry the most poorest of people because they were considered even lower than the poorest of these people. And he would fain, having filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. So who gave to him? No one. He could not find anyone that was willing to feed him. And so he's looking at these things that he's feeding these hogs, and he's like, man, I know these hogs are eating. It's got to be good. So if you study it, here's what these things are. These things in this parable, the person owning all things spoken of, the son wants to be his own man, if you will. He's telling his daddy, I'm grown. I've said that. Haven't we? I'm grown. I'm gone. And I'm not coming back. And then what happens? You come back. But the son wants to be his own man. He wants to do. He wants to go where he wants to go, where he wants to do. He wants to do it his own way. He wants to go his own way. And he don't want his daddy riding his tail and telling him, go left, go right, go straight. Keep on the narrow path, son. He wants to be able to get out and do his own thing. And so it doesn't last long. There's a famine. And so all the money that he had gotten from his daddy is gone. And so he's looking for somewhere, someone that he can tie himself to so that he can live. Now, in my time of being a wanderer, there was always somebody hanging around, and they would always try to glean off of everything that I had. And a few times I'd tell them, look, Bo, I don't care where you go, you just can't stay here. Because I barely have enough to keep me going, let alone pay for you. So you got to go. And so he's trying to tie himself to somebody that he can eat, that he can live, that he can do his own thing. But But he ties himself to the wrong people. And how do you know that it's the wrong people? Because he's not being fed. He's not being taken care of. He's out there feeding the hogs. And these things that he's feeding the hogs, you think of husks. We all think of corn husks. Well, it's not that. If you study it, it turns out that he is feeding someone else's hogs these things that he's deciding if he wants to even try to eat. And if you study that, it's called carob husks. They are long, bean-looking, similar to that of when I saw pictures of it, it reminded me of vanilla. Vanilla grows in long husks, and they have the bean inside of it. Well, this carob is similar to that. And studying it, it is noted that it can be given the person who is eating it different ailments, including diarrhea and some other things. But if you study more into it, it's put into soda. It's put into candies. It's put into cakes. It can be an imitation chocolate. So this carob, apparently, has anybody ever tasted pure vanilla without sugar? Have you ever tasted cocoa powder without sugar? You know, to me, that, yes, it is. But it sure smelled good, didn't it? Oh, man, that cocoa powder smelled just like chocolate. There I was about 13 years old. I'd put that tablespoon into that powder, and ow! It's amazing what sugar can do. But at any rate, so it also can be found as a substitute for sugar, for chocolate. Got my mind stuck on sugar now. So he is looking at these things that he's feeding these hogs, and he's saying, man, anything I could do to fill my belly. I'm hungry. And no one cared about his hunger. I mean, he's doing the lowest of lows of duties, of jobs. And so verses 17 through 19 says, and when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare? And I perish with hunger. And there's an exclamation point at the end of that verse in my Bible. Is there one in yours? An exclamation point? He's speaking that emphatically. And I hunger. My daddy's servants are being fed. And here I am about to die of starvation. Feels like my stomach's eating a hold of my backbone. Anybody's ever been there? I've been there. That's another story. I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. So he arose. He came to his senses. He realized, man, have I messed up. And in his mind's eye, he thinks, I have burnt the bridge to being called my father's son. I'm not worthy to be called my father's son. I'm not worthy to be even to look at my father in the face, if you will. But if I go to my daddy, I know that he would let me at least cut his grass. He'd let me mend his fence. He'd let me shear his sheep. He'd let me plant his garden. He'd let me do something that would be able to earn me something to eat. I'm going to my daddy. And I know that my daddy has all those things because all his servants have food on their tables. So he's come to his senses. What do you think brought that to his senses? Do you think it was really his hunger? No, I don't think so. See, I think the Father in this parable represents God the Father, as I've said. And God the Father owns everything. And so, therefore, I'm not calling him a prodigal father. I'm calling him the Father. And I'm telling you that the Holy Spirit is what brought it into his mind that says, you know what, you're a stupid idiot. Here you are dying of hunger because of your pride. Here you are. You have stepped away from your Father. You have stepped away from that relationship that you had it made in to do this. Boy, pick yourself up and get back to your daddy. You could just hear the Holy Spirit saying that, because he's come to the conclusion, if I just go back to my daddy and I become one of his servants, I'll have enough food to eat. And that's what he does. He arose and came to his father. What does that sound like? That whole part right there, what does it sound like? To me, it reminds me of 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. If my people, which are what? Called by my name. See, my last name is Smoak. Where did I get that name from? Yeah, I didn't get it from the mailbox. I didn't send a postcard off somewhere asking for a last name. Where'd I get it, Alex? From my daddy. So I'm called by his name. That ties me to him. And so therefore, those who are called by my name, if my people who are called by my name, yeah, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. How does that work? How does the word seek work? Can you do it with your eyes closed? No. You got to have your eyes opened. You got to be feeling for it. You know, for those that might be blind, you know, you don't have eyes to open, you don't have eyes to see, but you have other ways of being able to see, whether it be the echolocation that many of them are starting to learn nowadays, to where they can see the picture of a tree that's in front of them and walk around it. It's amazing. But yet they are feeling their way through. So in order to be able to seek something out, you have to be earnestly looking for it. Seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and what? Heal their land. So now the sad part is verses 25 through 32. I'm sorry, y'all. I skipped over one note. I was supposed to read verses 20 through 24. See, this is why I'm just Brad Smoak. I'm not no expositor or anything. So let's look at verses 20 through 24. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this, my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. I am so happy to be called Bobby Smoke's son. But I am more elated that I am called a child of God. I am beyond ecstatic to be saved, to be clean, to be given a ring of authority, to be given shoes upon my feet, to be having clothes upon my back, that of my Father, God the Father, because I was once lost, but now I'm found. I was once dead, but yet I live, because God the Father, through Jesus Christ, saved me. And I am so grateful that he did, and I'm so grateful that I have these letters of love so that I might know who my Father truly is. And what was the Father doing? He was looking for him. He was looking for his son. Any day now, you can almost imagine him sitting out on the front porch in his rocker, looking out over the horizon. Any day now, he's coming home. Any day now, I'm going to see his head come up over that hill, up over that crest. Any day now. Oh, wait a minute. What is that? I see somebody. Who is that? Stop rocking. Lean in his chair, squinting them eyes, looking. That's my son. And so what did he do? Did he just sit there and say, I knew that was going to happen. Come on, boy. Come on up here on my porch and beg me. Did he do that? What did he do? He ran to him. All right, so he came to his senses. He was called by the Father's name. He humbled himself. And he seeked out his Father. He seeked his Father's face. And his Father heard him and reestablished him as his son. So, the sad part. Verses 25 through 32, which finishes out this chapter. Now his elder son was in the field. And as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry and would not go. He would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son has come, or was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. Can't you hear the sarcasm in his voice? Can't you hear him trying to tear down even his own father? Can't you hear that? How heartbreaking it is to have the son speaking to him like that. The son who stayed. Kind of reminds you a little bit about Jesus' parable that says the man had two sons and he told one son, go hither. And the son said, I will not. And then he come to his senses and he went. And he went and told the other son, go thither. And he says, okay, Pop. And went his own way. And then Jesus said, which one did the will of the Father? It was the one that said he would not, but yet went. Because the one that said, okay, I'll do it, all he was doing was basically fluffing his daddy's pillow, making his dad feel good, knowing in the back of his mind, I ain't doing what that old man said. Is he crazy? So here he is telling his daddy, I have served you all these years and I have never caused any harm. The word was transgressed. I've never caused any harm at any time about thy commandments. You've told me what to do, and I've always followed your commandments all the way through to the nth degree. There wasn't a tittle or a dot that wasn't falling into place that I did not make sure that everything was done according to your will. And here it is, your son, he didn't even say my brother, your son has taken all your stuff that was his, and he has gone and wasted it, and now he's come back, and you're welcoming him with open arms? And I can't even have a kid? I can't even have a little goat or a little lamb to be able to roast on an open fire out in the middle of the woods with my buddies while we're shooting up a whole bunch of tents and everything? We can't go have fun? Dad, this just ain't right. That's what he's saying. You're letting him back into the family. You're giving him what's mine. And it ain't right. Can't you hear that? You're giving him my stuff. That's my inheritance. He's already had his, and he wasted it. And I've been serving you all these years. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Isn't it amazing how open-armed our Heavenly Father is? We can walk our own path, we can do our own thing, and yet He will welcome us back with open arms. So now, let's compare the two sons. So according to my study Bible, the two sons are contrasted. Now they start off along the same path, but there comes a point where they tend to fork away from each other, like a fork in the road. One goes to the left, the other goes to the right. And that works out because the right is the right path, right? Right. Amazing how right that is, isn't it? So the younger son, first of all, he lacks wisdom. And so we have read the results of the lack of his wisdom. He goes to his father and he says, everything that is mine, I want it to be mine because I'm tired of living up under your house, up under your rules, up under your thumb, and I want to be my own man. And so he goes and he ends up feeding the hogs and hungering for the stuff that he's feeding the hogs. So then there's penitence and humility. Penitence, he's come to the realization that he has been wrong, that he was wrong to talk to his father that way, that he was wrong to demand his father's money, to demand his father's the inheritance, and his father wasn't even dead yet. He was wrong in how he treated his father. He was wrong to leave his father. He was wrong to waste that money. He was wrong to do all the things that he wanted to do his own way. That's the penitence part. Then the humility. See, you could be penitent. You can have a broken heart without repenting to someone, because that's the humility part. You can say, I really messed that up, but I ain't telling nobody I messed that up. They just gonna have to figure it out. Because if I'm lucky, They'll think somebody else did it. That's the penitent part. But the humility part is going to the Father and saying, I'm sorry, Dad. I wronged you. Now, I'm not asking no longer to be your son because I know that I've already taken my part of the inheritance. I'm no longer asking to be called by your name. I'm no longer asking to have the authority to do business under your name. I'm just asking to allow me to be a servant because your servants are treated better than I was treated out there. So, that was the humility part. And because of that humility that come to his mind, that come to his heart, he returned home. And what was the reception that he was given? He was welcomed. His father was actually looking for him. His father was expecting him. Any day now, he's going to come up over that hill. Any day now, he's going to be back. He's going to be back under my wing. He's going to be back with me. He saw his father's compassion. Because see, his father could have said, no, bud, I have enough servants. And as far as I'm concerned, you've already got everything for me that you're going to get. You ask for your part of the inheritance. Everything else is his. Everything else is your brother's. You're going to have to go ask your brother. Because I've already divided everything between you fellas. So now you need to go ask your brother if he's going to allow you to be a servant. Don't come crying to me because you messed up. And he would have been justified in saying that. Just as well as God the Father is justified to say, no, I'm not going to forgive you. Man, don't you realize how many times I've forgiven you already? Don't you realize how many times you've asked me to forgive you and I have forgiven you every step of the way? But here's where I'm drawing the line. I've always heard as long as there's breath, there's hope. And I am so grateful because I am hard-headed. You know, I did tell y'all my last name was Smoak, right? I am hard-headed. But there's a lot of Harville in me, too. Y'all ask Mama. Everybody used to say I look like her. Used to be a woman I worked with out there at the Coastal Center. It used to say, your mama said, and there you were. Remember that, Mama? All right, so the father's compassion was towards his son. His confession to the father and the proof of humility is what made him a son. Again. And because of that, the father lavished him with gifts. The father made sure that he had shoes on his feet. You see, that's significant. He made sure that he had a coat. Made sure that he was clean and then a coat. And he made sure he had a ring. And all of that is significant. And we're going to go into that. And then there was the reason. What was the reason behind it all? Because he had lost everything. Everything under his own mind, everything under his own power. He felt that he had everything under control. You know, Dad is so old. I'm not talking about my dad. I'm talking this dude's dad. Dad is so old. He's stuck in the old ways. You ever heard that? He's stuck. The things that were relevant in his days are no longer relevant today. You even hear about that. People argue that about the Bible. The Bible is not relevant to today is their quote, not mine, their quote, because they're looking at it from a fool's point of view. The Bible in its entirety is as relevant then as it is now. And so that young man who says, Daddy's wrong, Daddy don't know, and I want to do it my way. Come to the reasoning, and his belly was telling him, you're an idiot, because I'm here biting your backbone, buddy, and you're hungry. Now go back to Daddy. So now let's compare that to the other brother. You see, they both lacked wisdom. And so the results from that, his brother was, the elder son, was angry. And he had sullenness. He had no empathy. He didn't care that his brother had come back. He didn't care. He was angry that his brother came back. He was angry that his father accepted him back. He was angry that the father gave him entreaty. He was bringing him back into the family. He had forgiven him, and he had made him a son again. And he was angry because this fool, this is not, this ain't Brad talking, this is the elder son. This fool goes off and wastes all of daddy's money, and he's going to come back and give it to him again? Not on my watch. Anybody ever met anybody like that? Yeah, I know a few people. And then he starts bragging on himself. I've been with you all these years. I never asked for anything. I have always obeyed your commandments. I have never sinned against you. I. So by him saying all these things that he did, it's the same thing as saying that's what he didn't do. I did this, he didn't do it. I did this, he didn't do it. I did this, he didn't do it. Now, I'm the better son. Kind of reminds you of the parable that Jesus talked about where y'all, I had that thing in my head just a second ago. I think it was a Levite who was at the temple, and he had his head bowed because he was so sad. He was so grieved over his sins that he could not even look his face up towards heaven because he was just so heartbroken. And he had his head down, and he was beating his chest, and he was saying, Lord, please forgive me for my sins. And then right next to him was a Pharisee who's over there saying, Lord, I thank you that I'm not like this fellow, because I know he sinned, and I'm good, and he's not. And I've never sinned. I've kept the commandments. I've done this, and I've done that. And I just thank you that you have kept me. I thank you that I'm able to stand here before you without any kind of blemish on me, and I'm just. And then Jesus said, who do you think left there forgiven? It wasn't that pious Pharisee. And so here we are talking about these two sons, and that one son is just saying, look, I've done this, and I've done this, and I'm righteous, and I'm righteous, and I'm righteous, and I'm righteous, and I've obeyed your commandments, every one. And yet, he's doing nothing but showing contempt to his father and to his brother. Showing contempt towards his father. How dare you forgive him? Excuse me? Don't you know who I am? Boy, I'm your daddy. I don't care how old you are. Y'all ever seen how little my daddy is? Y'all see that I had to lift this podium up just to be able to use this thing? This stand? The podium's up there. This stand? I had to lift it up just to be able to use it. But yet, my foot won't fit in his shoes. That man will lead me over his lap. Of course, he'll hurt for it because I'll break his knees or something. But that's my daddy. And the way that boy's talking to his daddy, I'm telling you, he better be glad his daddy was who he was. So he was bragging on himself. He had complaint against his father, and he had complaints against his brother, and he was complaining against his father's gift. He said, you know, I couldn't even have a lamb couldn't even have a kid. Or a baby goat. I couldn't even have a kid. And yet, you're killing the fatted calf. What did the father say to him? He didn't tell him, son. He didn't tell him, look, man, you got to go. He never said, you're no longer my son, did he? He never said, you know what? Away from me, for I never knew you. He didn't say any of that. He said, son, all that I have is yours. But that's your brother. You remember the boy was saying, your son? Your son? He wasted all your stuff, and he went riotous living, and he sinned against you. He has sinned against everything, and here he is coming back, and you're welcoming him back. And his father's saying, all that I have is yours. What is he saying in that? Dude, if you wanted a kid, you should have taken a kid. It was yours. If you wanted the fatted calf, you should have taken the fatted calf because it was yours. Because everything I have is yours and you are mine. Sometimes we got to be reminded of whose we are. And then there's the reason. Your brother was dead, and now he is alive. So then let's look at what Jesus is saying here. He's comparing that son, the elder son, to the Pharisees who he was talking to in this parable. He was bringing them about because they're snubbing their noses at everybody that isn't them. They're snubbing their noses at everybody that isn't saved. They're snubbing their noses at everybody that doesn't wear the right shirt or doesn't wear the right kind of pants or doesn't wear the right kind of shoes. They're snubbing their nose. You know, let me tell you this joke. There was this cowboy who came into this church. He had never been into that church before. Now, he was clean. He had this worn shirt on, but it was clean. He had his cologne on, so he was clean. He wasn't smelly. His boots were worn, but they were polished. His jeans were old, but they were clean. He had an old rugged Bible, and he come walking up into this church, and everybody's neck started bending, looking at who was this fella? Who does he think he is? And he comes right down the center aisle, sits right in the front, and listens to the preaching. So then at the end of the service, the pastor goes to the end of the doorway, and as that cowboy comes through, the preacher says, sir, I'd like for you to pray and ask God what would be the proper attire to wear to our church. He says, yes, sir, I'll do that right away. So the next Sunday, he's wearing those same jeans, he's wearing the same boots, he's wearing the same shirt, carrying the same Bible, clean, wearing cologne, clean. Did I say he was clean? Clean. Goes through the center aisle, sits at the front, listens to the service, goes out the door, and as he's shaking the pastor's hand, the pastor says, did you do what I asked you to do last week? He says, yes, sir, I most certainly did. And the pastor said, and? He said, God told me he didn't know what I should wear here because he's never been here. See, we got to be careful. As I've said many times, we're the Bible that some people will only read. If we don't represent God the Father, if we don't represent Jesus Christ well, how is it that we can say that we're his children? Now, it didn't stop this dude from being a son. He still said, everything I have is yours. But your brother was dead, and now he's alive. All right, so in comparison, the elder brother and the Pharisee had many points in common. First of all, they both murmured. How do you know that they murmured? Well, the Bible talks about how the Pharisees were always murmuring against Jesus. They were always trying to poison the people against Jesus. They were always doing everything in their power to be able to say that Jesus was not who he was. And how did the elder brother, murmur against his younger son? Well, first of all, he knew he was there and would not go in. So that right there lets you know that he was having angst against his brother. He was angry against his brother. He was angry against his father because the father allowed his brother to come in, and he was mad at the brother because the brother thought it was okay to come in. And so he goes wandering off. So they were both murmuring. They were both jealous of sinners because everything that he said to his father was to justify himself, because he was jealous that his brother got the fatted calf, that his brother was welcomed back with open arms, that his brother was brought back into the family. He's jealous over his brother, even though everything, as his father said, was his. He still wanted more. And he did not want his brother to enjoy any of it. They both lacked love for sinners. He did not love his brother. You could tell he really didn't even love his father. They both saw sinners being blessed. They both were ignorant of what was happening. They both were angry. They both were entreated. They both claimed to be justified in their actions. I'm still talking about the elder son and the Pharisees. Because this is who Jesus is talking against. They both sought to keep sinners from being blessed. They both had no mercy on sinners. They both bragged on themselves. They both were self-righteous. I have kept the law since my youth. Remember that one? A rich young ruler. How can I receive everlasting life? Well, obey the commandments. I've done all that since my youth. Okay. Now go sell all that you had and come follow me. Oh, wait a minute now. Now I can make sure that there are no other gods before God. I can make sure that I don't kill nobody. I can make sure that I don't do this. And I can make sure that I honor and obey my parents. I can make sure all these things. But now you're telling me I got to give up my money? You tell me I got to give up my house? You tell me I got to give up that car? You tell me I got to give up everything I've... No, man, I'm sorry. Well, then who was your God? They both bragged on themselves. They were self-righteous. They claimed to keep the commandments, but were lying to themselves. And they both found fault. Who was the brother finding fault with? The elder brother? Who was he finding fault with? You can guess and surmise that he definitely was finding fault with his younger brother. But was he talking to his younger brother here? So who was he finding fault? His daddy. He's basically saying, Daddy, do you realize you're stupid? Do you know, I say it like that and it sounds comical, but how many people talk to God that way? God, that was stupid. I don't want to do it that way. Go talk to this person. Not me. I'm not stepping out of my comfort zone. Or like it happened with me. Man, I'm crazy. I'm sitting over here talking to myself. Go pray with that fellow. I'm sitting here talking to myself. I ain't no way I'm going to go pray with that fellow. That fella has done me wrong. Do you want to go talk to that fellow? No, I don't want to go talk to that fellow. That's right. It's not you, it's me. Now get up and go pray with that fellow. Yes, sir. So both sons were wasteful. Both sons were wasteful. The youngest son just was more blatant about it. The youngest son was really, you know, I'm sad to say that there's been times where I used to smoke. And I smoked a lot. I smoked for 17 and a half years. And I can remember being told, you know, I'm glad that when you smoke, you don't hide it from anybody. The pastor of our church would drive by and I'd have the cigarette in my hand and I'd wave at him. Because I knew I was in the wrong. But why would I hide it from anybody? So one was very wasteful and he wasn't hiding it from nobody. Daddy, I want my stuff. I want what you have for me. I want mine. And I'm gone. He was wasteful. And he was blatant about it. The other son was just as wasteful, but he hid it behind closed doors, if you will. He had the ability to lavish in his father's wealth. He had the ability to take a kid if he wanted to, like he's sitting there complaining to his father. He had the ability to be able to use his father to his benefit. I mean, didn't God tell the king, says, why are you sending them your money? Why are you asking them for help? Well, don't you know we're getting ready to go to war? You come to me. I own the cattle of 1,000 hills. Because he says, well, what about our money? Do we need to ask for our money back? No. You've already lost that, buddy. But don't sweat it. Because I own the cattle of 1,000 hills. You come to me and I'll go to battle for you. I'll see you through. Isn't that what God the Father's doing? Isn't that what this Father's doing? Come back to me. I'm looking for you. I'm looking for you. Come back to me so that I can enjoy you and that you can enjoy me. That I can put you back in your place. What was that place? Sonship. I was beginning to wonder, was anybody listening? Sonship. He was made a son. He came asking to be a servant, didn't he? He said, I'm not worthy to be your son. I'm not worthy to be called your son. I'm no longer worthy to be called Smoke. And he said, buddy, you are my son. Like it or lump it, you are my son, and you're going to be my son. Both sons showed their own thoughts as to where they were in life. One says, here I am, it's all mine, and I want all of it. And the other one says, I just want what's mine, and I can go. The younger came to his senses. The elder was still home. But he was just as lost as the other. Because he was there, and yet he did not accept what was his. And you can tell that by the way he's talking. He was there and was just as lost. He had no remorse for his brother being gone. He didn't care. He didn't care that his brother had died. He didn't care that his brother came home. He didn't care that his father was rejoicing. All that he cared about was himself. He had all of his father's riches at his disposal, and he failed to see what was in his father's heart. The son, or daughter, if you will, that was lost is found. There he was, living with his own father, living at the same place, and didn't even know his father. Didn't know that his father cared. He probably didn't even know the father was sitting on the front porch looking over the horizon saying, any day now he's coming over that horizon. Any day. Oh, wait a minute. There's that head. That's my boy. Man, I'd recognize that haircut anywhere.
clean him. That's what he did. He went. See, he didn't sit on that porch. Like we said, he didn't sit on that porch and said, come on over here, son. Come to me. That's right. Keep walking. Come on. I'm going to act like I'm asleep. You're going to have to wake me up. I'm asleep now. No. He ran. And when he ran, apparently some of the servants ran with him. Why? How can you tell that the servants ran with him? Because he told them what to do. So he went running to his son, and the servants came running with him. And he says, clean him. Clothe him. Give him a ring on his finger. What did that ring signify? Ma'am? That he was the family. He was a representative of his father. See, that ring gave him power and authority. Jesus said, all power is given unto me, and the power that I have given unto you. You have all power and authority to be able to do anything, because if it's you asking in my name, it won't only be you asking, but it'll be me at the right hand of our Father asking for you. And my Father does what I ask him to do, because he loves me and I love you. And so the ring was the authority. He could go into the market and he could say, I need 1 million bushels of this. And they'd say, well, how are you going to pay for it? Right there. Let me give you this little stamp of approval. This is my Father's ring. My Father will buy this stuff. My Father, because I'm here under his, I'm doing my Father's business. I must be about my Father's business. So he gave him a ring. And then what'd he do? Amen. Somebody's listening. Y'all, people on this side, y'all need to wake up a little bit. Only ones answering me is mom and daddy. No, I'm picking. All right, so the ring and sandals were marks of a free man and of honor and of dignity. See, when somebody became a captive, their shoes were one of the first things removed. Their coats were another thing. They were only allowed to wear different rags, if you will, burlap sacks, if you will. And they were not allowed to wear shoes. So by putting a coat on him, by clothing him, by cleaning him, and by putting shoes upon his feet, he was letting it be known that this was no longer a slave. This was no longer a person outside of my family. This is my son. And because he's my son, he has my ring of authority upon him, and he can conduct business in my name, and anything that he does in my name, I'm going to do, because I'm going to prove to anybody and everybody that that is my child. How amazing is that? How amazing is it that our Heavenly Father says, you won't be naked, because you're mine. Don't worry about the food. I'll make sure you have it. Don't worry about the clothes on your back. I'll make sure you get it. My children won't be begging for bread. Now, let me ask you this. Had that son died in those fields, would he have been able to be redeemed? How can anybody read parables such as these and say there's no such thing as backsliding? How could anybody read parables such as these and say, I gave my heart to the Lord when I was 8 years old. Now give me another Budweiser and let me have some other stuff, you know, and this, that, and the other, and it be okay. See,
I know beyond the shadow of a doubt that the Bible says that all that have been given to me are mine and they are in my hand and nothing can pluck them out. But he doesn't say you can't get up and walk out. This is three parables that represent those that have backslidden. See, that sheep that was lost, where was it before it was lost? It was in the fold. He had 100 sheep. One walked off. He left the 99, the Bible said, in search for the one that was lost. Where was that coin before it became lost? It was in that woman's pocket. Well, probably her purse. We'll just say pocket. It was in her pocket. But she didn't know she had a hole in her pocket until she reached in there and she said, wait a minute. I've only got 9 pieces of silver. I got a hole in my pocket. I'm going to sew that hole up and find that 10th piece. So that 10th piece was in her possession, but it walked out. She seeked it out. She found it. So why didn't the father in that third parable go seeking after the son? Yeah, I know I'm the teacher, right? Because God the Father is still sitting upon his throne. The Holy Spirit is what awakened him to realize his wrong. Because if the Holy Spirit does not draw, then no one would come. Isn't that what the Bible says? Lest the Holy Spirit draw them, they'll never come unto me. If the Holy Spirit did not awaken that fella and say, you big dummy. Dude, don't you feel your stomach growling? I've been there. 3 days without food, on the road with a trucking company, and I'm not going to say that trucking company for fear of trademark. 3 days without food because I said I was going to, my very first per diem, I was going to buy me a carton of cigarettes. See, as a trucker, we could get per diem. We could get a little bit of a advance on our check. So that we could buy things like food, which is what I should have had in my head instead of those cigarettes. And I went 3 days without food. And so I went pulling into this truck stop, and I remember seeing this owner-operator sitting over there next to me driving for the same company, but he owned his own truck. And boy, that dude was all bubbly and giggly and everything. Don't you just love this company? Don't you just love driving for this company? Don't you just love this weather? And I'm like, shut up, man. Shut up. I'm going to fill my tanks. I'm going to drive to the back of this parking lot, and I'm going to try and sleep this hunger off so that I can deliver my delivery, my load into Cincinnati in the morning. And here it is, like 11 o'clock. I'm just so hungry. So I go on to the back of the truck stop parking lot. And I'm doing my log book, getting ready to bed down and try and sleep my hunger off. And boom, 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 boom. I look out my window, and there's that dude. I'm like, how did you... I look, he's parked catty corner from me. I'm like, how'd he even get here without me hearing him? And I open up the door. I said, yes, sir. He said, yeah, I know you said earlier that you couldn't sit down and have a meal with me because you just said you couldn't. He said, now, please forgive me for asking, but I really feel led to ask. Did you say you couldn't because you're running late on a load or because you can't afford it? What? That loud
voice in the back of your head saying, tell him you're running late on the load. Tell him you're running late on the road, on the load. And my stomach only had that little small, still voice that said, you know. You know you hungry, buddy. You know. And I said, sir, I can't afford it. He said, you don't worry about that today. You're going to eat. You finish up your paperwork, come on inside. And I was inside in a hurry, and I'm like, where'd he go? Where'd he go? Where'd he go? Where'd he go? Was he an angel? Was he an angel? Did he disappear? Oh, Lord, please don't let him disappear yet. I ain't ate yet. I found the guy. Sat me down at the table. He says, order anything you want. We had a TA truck stop. Truck Stops of America. I don't know if that's a trademark or not. So at any rate, order anything you want on that menu. I said, BLT and fries. He said, wait a minute now. If you want a steak, order a steak. I said, sir, as long as it's been since I've eaten, this is going to taste like a steak. He said, oh, okay. I had that BLT and fries. Man, that was the best BLT I've ever had in my life. I remember sucking my fingers. And so I left there that day with a meal, with a bunch of tapes of preaching that he had given me, and $20 in my pocket. All because I prayed, Lord, if you'd just give me $20 so that I can get me something to eat, I promise you I won't buy any cigarettes. And I've been smoke-free ever since. That was before my kids were even born. And they'll be 21 next month. Time flies when you're having fun. So with that being said, I'm going to read one last thing. Oh, I already read that, didn't I? All right, good. So that's the end of my sermon. So, let's go ahead and pray the benediction. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we glorify you.